Hi, I'm Andrew Brown. Welcome to Real Time Music and Sound with Pure Data. In this episode, we're going to be looking at building a step sequencer. Let's just talk a little bit about what a step sequencer is. Here's an image of an analog step sequencer in the traditional style. You'll see there's two rows of eight dials, so this becomes a 16-step sequencer. At each step, the dial can change a voltage from low to high, and then that voltage can change some value, for example, the pitch or the filter cutoff or some other aspect of our synthesizer. So this notion of sequencing is a series of steps, one after the other, usually at a regular interval between steps, and you can speed up and slow down the cycle. So when there's 16 steps like this, the counter will go from the first one through to the last one and then back and create a sequenced loop. All right, let's see how we can build one of these in PD. The first thing we're going to do is to start with the metronome object. The metro puts out a series of pulses, a series of beats or bangs, in fact. And so we can start that with a toggle. And so that we can see the output, we'll just put a bang under there. So typically, a metronome takes a value for the speed at which its pulses are going out. And you can see that as I increase this number, which is by default in milliseconds, that the speed of the bangs slows as the amount of time between each bang increases. In musical systems, it's kind of more normal that we would think about the speed of our metronome in beats per minute. And so PD allows us to do this, the metro. We can send this message tempo. I'm going to take in the value as an argument. And importantly, I'm going to provide an argument, the per min, which is short for beats per minute. So now this metro object, if I pass that message into the metro, like so, and I can control the volume. If we restart the metronome, and then pull this number down, say something close to 120 beats per minute, which is about one every half a second. You can see the flash there. This time, interestingly, as I increase the number, the flashes, the bangs get quicker because we're doing more beats per minute. And so there's our tempo control for our sequencer. All right, so we'll just leave that keep going. The next thing which is important in sequencing is to be able to count these steps. We need to be able to count from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to whatever number of steps we want to have. So in PD, we can implement a counter using a floating point object. This is like a number box which will store a number, and we can increment that number, so we can add 1 to it. So every time a bang goes to the float, it will output the number. If we take the number that is output and we add 1 to it but feed it back in, then it will increase by 1 every time. You'll notice that we put the inlet back in the right. The right will set the number box but won't output it, but the bang will output it. If we want to see what's happening inside, you can connect a number box, and you can see that the counter is just continually counting up every time we get a bang. Of course, if we increase the tempo, then those numbers simply increase. Okay, so that's all good and well. But of course, we don't have 55, 56, 57 steps in our sequence. Who knows how many we'll have, but certainly not that many. And so we're going to need to make sure that this number reverts back to one and then keeps going like that, up, builds up, and then comes back. There's a mathematical function called modulo, which we use for doing that. And in this case, I'm just going to modulo 4, which means that it's going to divide the number that's coming in by 4, and the modulo will output the remainder. So we can see what that is with another number box. And so this process of just getting the remainder by dividing by 4 in this case, the number that's coming in, gives us a nice counter which goes from 0 up to 3, 0, 1, 2, and 3. So in this case, we're building a 4-step sequencer. The next step in our sequence, now that we've got our numbers coming in, is to select those numbers and to be able to route them differently. So a select object will look for the arguments, and when it gets those arguments, it will send an outlet out each of those things. So we can connect that up, and we can see what's going on if I put a bang object. So this bang object is at the first outlet, which is 0 in this case. So whenever we get 0 in our counter, 0 is selected and that first outlet is banged. The same thing happens for all of the others as well. There is a final outlet on the select which will send out any other value that might come in. But in this case, we're only interested. So we can now see we're getting our sequence going 0, 1, 2, 3, and then repeating. So we've got a nice 4-step sequence going on here. So what are we going to trigger with our sequence? I think it might be nice to do a fairly classic thing and to sequence a pitch. So it means that every one of these is going to trigger a different pitch. To do that, I'm going to use a series of number boxes. So this first bang will trigger this number box, and we'll do that for each of them. So there's the second one, trigger a second number box, third one, a third number box, and oops, not a symbol, and the fourth one, fourth number box. So this allows us to specify what those will be. I'm going to set the properties of this so that they go from, we're going to use these as kind of MIDI note numbers, so from 0 up to 127, because what we'll do after that is we'll eventually pass this through MIDI to frequency in order to give us frequency for our oscillator. But just to make sure this is a bit easier to use, I'm going to change the properties of each of these number boxes so that they range from 0 up to 127. So at the moment we can pass that through a MIDI to frequency and we'll get a frequency, but before we get to the MIDI frequency, I want to provide one more bit of functionality, and that is to put in another select box and look for the number 0. And I'm going to use the MIDI pitch of 0 to effectively mean no change, or so that if we get a 0, then it won't change the pitch. We'll just continue with the previous pitch. So it's kind of like the ability to turn a step off, if you like. So then that will go through there. If we put a number box to see the value, oops, my mistake. We want to select numbers that are not 0 to come out the right outlet of the select. And there we go. So our 87 produces a frequency of 1244 Hz. And our other values will go like so into our select. And we can specify those to be something else. And so as you can see, we are now changing our frequency on every step. And if, for example, we put one of those back to 0, then we don't get any change on that particular step. Okay, So this is all appears to be working. We can see it visually, but we can't yet hear anything. So let's start work on making sure that we can hear something. So I'm going to move over here, and we'll just create fairly straightforward sawtooth wave using our phaser object. We need to make sure that it's bipolar, so the input multiplied by 2 minus 1 will give us that bipolar shape that we need. Our frequency will go into the phaser. Of course, we're going to need to have an amplifier to control our volume, and that will go to a DAC so we can hear what's going on. And we'll want to have a control over our volume, so I'll put a slider to control that volume. That will go between 0 and 1 for the range for volume, so that's fine. We know that the sawtooth wave is going to be pretty bright, so let's put a low-pass filter on it, just so it sounds a little bit less strident. Okay. Okay, and if we put one of these to 0, you can hear this 35 mini note number. Okay, so we have our sequencer working. And we can control the pitch by changing these numbers, and all the rest of it happens. One other thing which is pretty common in analog sequences, though, is that not only can we make this jump from frequency to frequency, but we can also glide between those frequencies. It's often called a slew. Actually, I think in fact what we'll do is the slew will go above the phaser. So let's move that, put that back in, turn the volume down for the minute. So we are going to use a line tilde object to create a line, a ramp between the different frequencies as they come in. We need to provide a message to that line object. It's going to take the frequency as the first argument and the slew time, or the ramp time, as the second argument, like so. In order to get two arguments into our message box, we need to use a pack object to pack two values together. Those two values will be, first of all, the frequency that we want to go to, and the second one will be the time that we want to take in milliseconds for that ramp to happen. The properties of that, some zero will be the smallest, and something like, we're unlikely to want to go any higher than 500. So this will be our slew rate. Okay, so if we turn the volume back up. So with the slew rate at zero, we still get a quick jump from one to the other. But as we increase this, we now get a ramp from pitch to pitch. We could, of course, change our tempo. Now, the student amongst you may notice that this tempo here, 308, is pretty fast, yet that's still not playing really fast, and that's because each of these is actually one beat. It's typical that you would have a sequencer to do, think about it as like 16th notes in a beat or something like that. So we can do something like that here. We can say that we want each of those counts to be quarter of a beat. We'll give it a sort of a starting tempo of 120, and of course we're in the per min thing. So as we do this, we're going to restart that, turn the volume up. So now we're doing 200 quarter notes per minute, or 216th notes, in fact, rather, per minute, a quarter of a beat each of these. And that's when we're now at something like 120, which is a pretty standard tempo. These are acting like 16th notes, in a sense, rather than beats. And we can in order to create a longer sequence, we can just increase our select here, change the modulo from 4 to 16, for example, or any number that we want. We just need to create more of most of the things around here so that we get, you know, 16 different values that we can change if we want a 16-step sequencer, and so forth. But I will leave that as an exercise to you, and see you in another video.